This is Caviar Ears with Brian Geller. Unlocking the secrets of the music industry.
The numbers all go to 11.
You're about to get the inside scoop from the industry insiders.
You the guy with the Van Halen ticket?
You never know what you're going to hear on Cover Your Ears.
Now raise your goblet of rock.
Happy Podcast Tuesday, friends, musicians, and family. Welcome to this edition of the Cover Your Ears podcast. You're listening to episode number 11 here at Ultimate Ear Studio in Southern California, and I'm your host, Brian Geller. I hope everyone had a great Christmas. Now, I have to tell you, it's so hard to believe 2016 is coming to an end. Speaking of which, if you're in Southern California and don't have New Year's Eve plans, let me personally invite you to spend it with the Atomic Punks. We'll be at the OC Fairgrounds in Costa Mesa, and evidently, lots of bands and lots of fun is planned. Remember, everybody loves Van Halen. This episode of Cover Your Ears is brought to you by Ultimate Ears Pro, setting the standard for custom in-ear monitors for more than 20 years. I've been using Ultimate Ears in-ear monitors for over 6 years now, and they're the real deal. If you're a musician and still using wedges, take it from me, no joke, give yourself a break and take your performance to the next level with custom in-ear monitors. Musicians, my singing career was about done. Too much singing to go with lots of bad technique. Ultimate Ears changed everything. To learn more, visit pro.ultimateears.com. So I met today's guest at NAMM a couple years ago. He's a super good guy. Frank Murray, bar none, is Tom Petty. Now, our general manager at Ultimate Ears was at a corporate party up at Logitech, or what we call at UE, the mothership, and was lucky enough to watch Frank and his band, Petty Fever. That following Monday, he couldn't stop raving about Frank's uncanny resemblance and his spot-on music replication of the Tom Petty catalog. Frank and his band hail from Oregon, and when he told me he would be down in Southern California for a couple gigs, I jumped at the chance to have him come in and hang out. So check it out. This is good stuff. All right, here we are, Ultimate Ears. It's the day past the big election, and it's about Tom Petty today. We got Frank Murray here with us. What's happening, brother?
Yeah, still waking up.
Now, you guys were down. How long you been down in L.A. for?
We flew in yesterday morning at 6:30 a.m. Don't ask me why. We could have flown in the afternoon. So we got into L.A. about 9-ish and hung out on the beach all day. You know, it was rough. Went over to the Whisky and played the Ultimate Jam last night.
Yeah, we were talking about that. So that the Ultimate Jam's been going on, you know, probably about a year and a half, and started at the Lucky Strike. Now it's over at the Whisky. So how was that experience? What did you guys end up playing?
Well, we did a 20-minute set. You know, started off with Running Down a Dream and Breakdown, Here Comes My Girl. And then they had a theme for the night. All songs had in the jam portion were politically connected somehow.
Got it. Okay.
And the last two songs of our set were I Won't Back Down and American Girl, which are both controversial because candidates in the past had used them as their theme song without.
Perfect for last night.
Yeah, without getting permission. And Petty had a fit, you know. So I thought those were appropriate to end our set with.
So when you're doing Tom Petty, you're doing Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, and are you doing solo Petty stuff?
Yeah, I mean, we're doing anything Petty.
I mean, dude, I'm looking at you, and it's like he looks like Tom Petty. You know, he's. We're also here with Craig here. Craig is the driver / drummer, and when I said he looks like Petty, Craig's like nodding.
He definitely looks like Petty. In fact, that's actually, as a side story, that's how we started doing this. People always stop Frank and say, hey, Tom, hey, Tom. And so we had some friends who were doing a Stones tribute, the Rolling Tones, and they said, hey, why don't you open for us? And Frank said, hey, why don't we do this just for fun of it? Because people are always saying. So we did it, and it went over so well. Maybe we should do this again. And before we knew it, we were touring around doing casinos and big shows. And
So how long has the gig been going on now?
7.5 years.
Wow.
Started in April 2009.
And Petty Fever is based in
Portland,
Oregon.
Yeah.
How's the scene out there for tribute bands?
Oh, it's huge.
Is it big up
it's
there?
It's almost, well, I can't say almost like L.A., but there is a scene. There's a local promoter slash manager slash agent guy, Jason Feldman. He has cultivated our tribute scene, and we got some great bands up there. And he puts on an event called Hairfest every summer, and it's turned into kind of the premier tribute festival. You know, they get 10,000-ish people for 2.5 days.
Is that right?
It's on a racetrack, you know, like a mini IndyCar track, and they've got RV parking, tents, and everything. And
people love tribute bands. You know?
Yeah,
if you miss seeing the band originally, and you get the opportunity, or you know, maybe the band's still out there today, but you know, isn't quite bringing the kind of show. And they're fun, you know. I mean, so I got to ask. Do we have any Van Halen tributes in Portland, Oregon?
We have one that I would consider good.
Really?
Yeah.
I mean, what I say down here is Van Halen tribute bands are like growing on trees. One seems to pop up somewhere each and every week.
Yeah, you know, I'd say I was a marketing guy in my past life for Carver Pro Amp Company, and so I do a lot of market research, and when we got into this thing, I researched, you know, what our competition was. I guess you'd call it competition, you know, what other Petty tributes are out there.
Right.
There's a lot of them. You know?
There is. Now, is there any up there competing with you?
There's a few, and I know all these guys, and you know, they always want me to come and kind of be a guest for their tribute show.
You're the guy, the go-to guy. Can you guys now? Do you have the relationship with these bands to where you know, say, Craig has a family obligation and is gone and can't play drums on a last-minute gig? Can you call one of these other guys up and from the other Petty bands and have them fill in?
Well, logistically, they're pretty spread out, you know. I mean, one guy band's up north of Seattle, and the other guys are from around Portland.
Let me rephrase. If they were down the street, would you feel comfortable calling them up? Do you have that kind of relationship where guys are all cool with each other?
Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
That's refreshing to hear because that does not happen down here. Not just in, you know, the Van Halen circles, but pretty much the only bands I see that happening with here in L.A. are maybe like the Beatles bands.
Right.
Everybody else, it is war.
You know, I had some issues with my voice a couple of years ago from allergies and not knowing what was going on. And I lost my voice. The guy, the other singer in that other Petty tribute was willing to come sing for me.
Very cool.
For our gig. And I actually got a guy that is like the top John Fogerty tribute guy in probably the world.
Really?
He just happened to know a bunch of Petty songs, and we had a casino date, Tulalip Casino. And
we know we play up there.
I got permission from the agent to have him come sing for me. I just played, you know, and he said he did a great job. But
it's a great show.
There's a lot of camaraderie
right
in the tribute scene up there. You know, everybody's kind of helping everybody. It's pretty cool.
There were 14 years in L.A. I spent here and found the same thing that you just spoke about, and then moved to Portland, Oregon, and everybody is so friendly. The musicians are. There's probably 5 drummers that have taken my place. Last year, I was wanted to see my daughter in Germany, and Frank probably had 5 gigs, and the drummers beg to do. I mean, they just love doing the shows, and so I never have to worry. If I can't do a show, there's guys lining up to do it. And they're great guys and good drummers.
That's a good thing. I mean, and I wish that was the case for the situations around here. You know, I had
Jessica Miller from Rumors, a Fleetwood Mac tribute, you know, and she and her band are at war with the other Fleetwood Mac tributes. Showing up to a gig and, you know, they got the posters of the other band or vice versa.
With rings around them.
Right. So, you know, today I heard that is the 40th anniversary.
The first album.
First Tom Petty album.
Yeah, you're correct.
Did we plan that like that, or was that perfect, or what?
Yeah, you know, I did a gig a couple weeks ago that we actually celebrated that just because we're going to be down here, but doing a gig tonight where I'm kind of going to put a little focus on
will
the
you play the Will you play that album from top to finish in order?
I wish I could do that, but
it kind of doesn't work. I've done that in bands before where we're doing Van Halen 1 from start to finish, and it just doesn't go over well.
The deep cuts sometimes are tough to pull off unless you're a diehard fan. And, you know, they're out there, but you're doing tribute bands. You know, they want the hits, the meat and potatoes, and, you know, We sneak in the deep cuts, B cuts here and there because we love them.
You love them, and you got to keep your sanity. And that's what makes it fun. You know, I mean, for us, it's like, okay, here we go, jump again.
You know? Yeah, it's the free bird of the tribute scene.
Exactly. Yeah, I was listening actually to Howard Stern this morning, and he had Sting on the radio, and Sting went in and they jammed, and I guess he had a police tribute band come in and play with them. And Howard's talking to the Sting impersonator tribute guy. He's like, "Are you taking lessons?" You know, but I mean, that's the ultimate, right? Is to play, you know, with the actual artist that you're paying tribute to, or maybe you get a member of their original band.
Yeah.
Have you guys had anything like that?
No, you know, there's a lot of disconnects, you know, where we know people that play with some of the guys and some of their side bands and this and that. But, you know, there hasn't been that connection, really. You know, and one part of me says I'd feel really uncomfortable in that scenario. You know, it's like a guy's trying to imitate Tom Petty. You know, he sucks.
Yeah, it's interesting to cross that line. We just did the Monsters of Rock cruise, and
oh, that, you know, sounds like fun.
It was a lot of fun, and all these '80s bands, and you know, they're the, you know, it's their bands and so forth. And we were one of two tributes that were on the ship, and it's kind of a funny feeling being a tribute, you know. But I kind of, you know, we realized that when you look at a lot of these bands, there's either two of the bands, you know, whether it's, you know, LA Guns or Great White or the different versions of Rad out there. But most of these bands, even if it is just one and not two, they might only have one or two original guys anyway. So they're kind of tributes themselves.
Yeah, that is a funny point because, you know, you look at all the, not all, but a lot of those bands that are out doing the summer fair circuit or whatever, you know, there's one guy, in some cases, not even one guy, just, you know, the manager or whoever owns the name, it's got a band out there, you know.
Exactly. So where'd you grow up?
Portland.
So you grew up in Portland, so you stayed there your
Yeah,
whole
I
life.
Mean, I've been everywhere. My old job, I did all the music trade shows around the world, and we had distributors everywhere, and you know, luckily I was in the music industry related field, kind of like you are, and so everywhere I went there was a band for me to play with, so I got to see the world. And
so when did you first pick up a guitar? I mean, was your family real musical? How did it all come about?
I started taking piano lessons when I was 5. My mom created a game, kind of like a Monopoly game with the game board, and had quarter notes, 8 notes.
Wow.
Out of little pipe cleaners and little wax things. And that's how I originally started learning music. And then I took, my dad was a teacher, and he had me taking piano lessons from a professor he knew at a college in Portland. And then I saw the Beatles' Hard Day's Night and Beatles on Ed Sullivan. It's like,
that was it.
Guitar. no more piano. Yeah, that was, you know, in life-changing moments, those were the moments. So.
So it was the Beatles that got you started. What about as you got a little bit older and finding
I heard Jeff Beck and Jimi Hendrix, and that was it. That kind of sent me down a road. And as far as a guitar player,
right?
I actually became a huge Petty fan when I saw his first show or his first tour. They came to Portland in like 77. They opened for the Ramones.
Wow.
So I think it was $1.92.
So you were there. You were there as a fan from the beginning.
I'm not that old, but you know, I was just like one. I think no. I was. I was a fan from day one. Killer band, you know, killer songwriter.
Yeah, and you know, Mike Campbell.
Yeah, he's an unsung hero in my world. He cannot play a wrong note. Every little lick he does, tone he uses is just, God, that's just the right thing for that song. It's just
wow,
amazing. That's the way I see it.
Yeah, I had an opportunity probably about the second year I was into the whole tribute thing, and we were playing at an Italian food restaurant, you know, that had a bar and kind of a cool place in Long Beach here locally. And we opened for the Dirty Knobs.
Oh, Mike Campbell's band.
And wow, blown away by this guy. To see somebody like that with that kind of talent, you know, right there, you know, in a real small place. And I don't know where he was in the whole Petty relationship at that point, but he had some dreadlocks going on. Oh, yeah. And boy, there was some things going on with this guy.
Did you watch him sing carefully?
You know what was interesting about that? It was almost like it was Tom Petty singing.
That's what I was going to say. He is like morphed his style, the way he moves his mouth. Like I saw him at a NAMM show party a couple. Well, I've seen him a few times. And a bass player I play up with up in Portland every once in a while. His buddy plays bass in the Dirty Knobs, and so you know we went out and checked him out, and anyway, I'm watching. I was going, "Holy crap! He's singing like Tom. He even kind of sounded like him." It's like, "Oh man, you're around somebody long enough that just happens."
Well, he's got a second career as a Tom Petty tribute band guy, right?
You know, speaking of that, kind of going back to other Tom Petty tribute bands,
right?
So. Yeah, you know, there's a lot of them out there. Yeah, I don't know how many are down here, but
we've got a few down here.
Yeah, and we usually do pretty good, you know, getting great gigs. But whenever I've the particular agents I work with or whatever, you know, address this Southern California area,
right?
You know, it seems like maybe there's a good old boy network thing going on. It's like, well, so and so knows so and so at that casino, and you know, we can't rock that boat.
It is. It's a whole little click type thing. I mean, honestly, most of our business is out of LA. You know, I would say 75% of what we do, you know, is fly in, fly out gigs. You know, and it's I think a lot of things. I think there's so many bands out there now doing it. I think a lot of your top 40 and your cover bands have this illusion that, oh, the way to make money in a band nowadays is to be in a tribute band. And it's like anything, it's a lot of work. You know, it just doesn't happen overnight. And I think going out to areas that doesn't have a big music scene has been real beneficial for a lot of the, you know, upper echelon tribute bands.
Yeah, that's where it's at, really. And you know, the crowd really appreciates you, and you know, you kind of feel like a rock star.
Yeah, you get a little bit. You get a little flavor, a little taste of what it must be like. And then you get a big taste of what it truly is like that you know, the average person doesn't understand it. You know, we don't get paid to play these songs. We get paid to travel to do these songs. And that's the nightmare of it.
Yep.
Yeah, how many gigs are you guys doing a year right now?
Oh, you know, it's unfortunately, I'd say it's seasonal for us because we definitely have seasons up there. And, you know, it kind of goes from April to October. And, you know, I'd say we're 30-ish gigs, somewhere around there. And I'd love to fill in the winter gap. But, again, it's the sunny, warm states have that.
Right. Now, how does that work with your day job? What do you do during the week?
Oh, call agents.
Is this a full-time gig for you?
Yeah.
Wow, hats off. Hats off, man.
When I was working, Carver fell victim to the economy meltdown back in 2008. And so I had to make an executive decision at the time if I was going to continue on in the audio industry and literally have to move to another city, you know, where like here or somewhere, Phoenix. I just decided I'd give this a shot. And, you know, I play in a few other bands to fill in the gaps.
And you were telling me you kind of run like a similar kind of jam night like they do here in L.A.
Well, after being here, it's not similar, but I wish it was, you know. It's pretty well run jam, but it's a lot more casual. But I've done one of them. Believe it or not, for 10 and a half years, the more I think about it, that's just scary. 10 and a half years running a jam. I do two of them, and it's pretty casual because I have guys that can fill in for me because I got to go in and out of town, you know, fairly often and such. But, you know, that ultimate jam, I tell you that.
Yeah, Chuck Wright of Quiet Riot runs it, and he does a great job. Like I was telling you guys before, I had done it about a year ago, and he's got the chart backstage and the exact times. And I remember when I first walked in, I said, are you kidding me? Musicians going on time. This stuff never, ever works out. No. And gosh, sure enough, I mean, he had that thing within a couple minutes. I mean, it was crazy. Yeah.
I mean, that in my perfect world, that I would love to run things like that. I don't think that would work in our particular environment. Yeah, but we have great players up there. I mean, a lot of touring guys and, you know, semi-famous, now even famous guys. You know, they pop in here and there. So, you know, it's fun for the crowd because you never know who's going to show up. Here, I think they're used to having a lot more celebrity visits than we
never know who will walk through the door.
And everybody enjoys it. The whole motive of doing a jam night like that is everybody has fun, whether you're playing up on stage. You know, you're a guy that's actually really good but doesn't play with bands, you know. This is your chance to get out in front of people. I try to give people that opportunity. It's not more a showcase for, you know, well-established players, but it's also an opportunity for guys to, you know, have their chance to get out in front of people and settle their nerves.
So we've known each other a couple years, and it's interesting how we met. Actually, Philippe, the general manager here at Ultimate Ears, was up at Logitech. You know, Logitech owns Ultimate Ears. We call them the mothership up north, right? And so Philippe was at a corporate party location, and you guys were hired to play. And he came back to the office, and, you know, obviously he knows what I do. He's like, oh, Brian, he goes, this band's unbelievable. And so he got on YouTube, and we started checking it out. I mean, you guys are nailing it, man. I've seen a few different Petty tributes out there, and you got it going on. And one thing that I realize is the catalog that you get to choose from and what to play. Tell me about the set list. Do you guys run the same show? Do you guys mix and match? How does it work?
I call them the meat and potatoes set list, you know, the hits. his number one song of all time for airplay and charts is Free Fallin'. I've got a list like that that I kind of use as a core. And then
do you have about, I know with the Van Halen stuff, there's probably, you know, if you've got a 90-minute set, 18, 19 songs, there's probably 12 to 13 we have to play.
Yeah, exactly. And even depending on who's booking us, you know, they're saying, what, you got to play these songs, you know.
Right.
And
when you have the more chick-friendly type show, it's like, we got to have to play these songs, you know.
Yeah, and, you know, exactly. But, you know, all of us have our favorites. And like you said, he has a deep catalog. I mean, he's just got a lot of great songs. And
do you dip into any Traveling Wilburys?
Yes.
Perfect. Yeah. Which ones do you do?
Well, of course, they're hits. Handle with Care.
End of the line.
Right.
So, and we're going to add some Mud Crutch in there, too. That's some good stuff as well, which anybody doesn't know was his first band back in Florida.
Which you hear a lot of, too, if you listen to the Petty radio show.
Petty Radio.
He's got it on Sirius XM.
Actually, that's a pretty good radio station. He's entertaining.
Do you get some tidbits as far as you pick up anything, as far as what you can use when you're playing, as far as like maybe banter with the crowd or songs? Or do you, I mean, is there anything you get out of his show?
Yeah, all the above.
It is. People don't realize it's not something like, okay, I'm doing this and I know Tom Petty and that's it. It's you can always learn something. You can always pick something up. You can always change something.
Yeah, you know, whether I'm listening to a live CD, I've seen him live a number of times, but yeah, I'm always listening. You know, I'm not like trying to copy him. I kind of do my own thing. And just ironically, a lot of what I do is kind of what he does anyway. So it seems to fit. But, you know, he's a pretty entertaining radio guy.
It's actually been on a while. A lot of those things kind of come and go after a few months, but he's had it happening for a while.
Yeah, he's actually kind of funny. So
so which Tom Petty song you like playing the most?
Depends on what day of the week
it is.
You know, I just, God, there's some money I like playing. I mean, you know, one day if I'm just like really going, you know, and it, again, it's one of the hits. So I love Running Down a Dream, just that driving beat, it's just, you know, just get you going. You know, an old B cut, Fooled Again, off the first album. That's just a greasy groove, you know, just love that one.
Dig a little deep with maybe a little Woman in Love.
Yeah, we do that one. Love that one, too. You know, it brings you up and it brings you down.
Right.
And got the right guy on sound, you know, just doing those little nuances with the trailer echo or something.
Now, how many guys are in the band?
Five.
So five guys. A lot of mouths to feed, especially if this is your full-time gig, right?
You're correct. But now, I'd love to feed these mouths because these guys are great.
So five guys now. How long is it? Same five guys
Same five guys.
That's amazing.
This April will be 8 years.
That's definitely something that's impressive.
Yeah. And, you know, we're all good friends, and we seem to click well together. You know, even if everybody snores when we're traveling, it's okay. I can deal with it.
That, I tell you what, man, that's half the battle, is being able to do this with guys you like to hang out with. They're family. They're like your brothers.
Yeah, that's 85% of it right there. I've been fortunate almost in every band I've been in to be around guys I like being around. Over the years, when there was somebody that didn't quite work out so good, that's being nice.
Being nice.
You know.
We got that, right.
It just, you know, things seem to correct themselves somehow. you know, no. I feel very fortunate.
No, I'm with you. The Atomic Punks, the current version of the Atomic Punks, and this is a band that's been around 22 years.
Yeah.
And I've been a part of it for just about 6 years, and it's still the current lineup. And it's something I hadn't really thought of until this year. And it's really something to be proud of, you know, to have the same core people for that long. And I mean, in any type of relationship, let alone a band that's a tribute band.
Yeah, it's like being married to four right. other people.
Right, that's what I said, married to three guys, you know.
You know, it's really cool in Petty's biography, if you haven't read it, by Warren Zanes, who was, what, Del Fuego's? Is that the band he was in? Anyway, he went off and got his degree in creative writing and then taught musicology at university. And he wrote Petty's book, Petty Taking the Bait, his
right.
book. And the one thing Petty just really focuses on all throughout his biography is he just wants to be in a band.
Really?
It's being in a band. It's not about him. It's being in a band. He thinks that's the ultimate thing. And I think that's what you two guys were just talking about. We really feel that way when, I mean, we just have fun together. We're kids again. And we're just a band. It's just a band. And it felt that way on stage last night. There was a moment, and here comes my girl. And I'm just thinking, God, it's a band. It's just a band.
Absolutely.
And so good.
And there's sometimes where you fight with your guys and stuff, and then you sit back and go, okay, why are we fighting? We're all dealing with the same airlines that is hammering us here. And it's quite something. You know, we have a situation right now. We're recording this, I said, the day after Election Day. So this is probably going to air sometime, I would say, in January. But, you know, the punks right now, we're dealing with an issue where our bass player is taking a couple weeks off in December. There's the slight possibility that he might not be in the band anymore. Boop. And so it really, it took the three of us back a little bit. It's like, how can we bring somebody else into our, you know, our little fraternity here? And, you know, we started looking around, and it's funny. I actually called Todd Jensen, yeah. your friend. I'm like, hey, Todd, you know, Todd, who'd played with David Lee Roth before, great bass player, and I'd hit him up. I'm like, what are you up to? And we ended up actually getting James Lomenzo from White Lion, and he was Roth's bass player for years in the early 2000s that's going to play with us. And, you know, I don't want anybody else to play in a band. This is Joe's band, and, you know, it really made me realize how lucky we've been to have this group of guys, and hopefully it's going to work out and he's going to be able to stay on. And if it doesn't, well, it was a nice run.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, I getting back to getting people to fill in, when I'm booking gigs, it's a challenge because I want to have these guys on it. And, you know, everybody has stuff going on, so sometimes it's pretty tricky getting all the calendar dates in alignment. And
so how do you guys work that? So is it something where your guys all have to be available every weekend and you book the band, and if there's certain dates that your guys need off, they need to let you know in advance? How do you guys work that, part?
That's the perfect world part of it, you know. And if we're working year-round, steady every week, which right now isn't the way it happens. Like I said, it's seasonal, more seasonal. We do stuff throughout the winter, but not anything like summer.
Yeah, and I think that's the same thing for us. We could play like eight shows in August, and then 2 months later, we might only be playing once or twice. So
I'll put out a feeler. A lot of times I'll just book the gig and, you know, do the Hail Mary. And it's like, hey, guys, guess what? And that usually works out pretty good. Craig here is probably the biggest challenge because he travels all around the world and does speaking engagements and whatever else you do.
The agency.
Yeah, what is it you do, Craig? So you're the drummer of the band.
Yes.
And from what I've learned this morning, the actual driver, are you driving everywhere?
Yeah, I just make sure Frank gets
He knows
somewhere.
LA really
yeah,
well.
I lived here for 14
Why is it
years.
That there's always one guy in the band that does all the driving, though? Does that work out with you guys?
A lot of times I do all the driving, but Craig's the L.A. guy.
It's, we come to L.A., it's easier for me to...
So are you from L.A., Craig?
No, I grew up in the Seattle area, but moved down here as a musician and spent 14 years here before moving to Portland. And I started an ad agency in Portland with my business partner, Ken, and we focus on exactly what this great carton of water that you gave me here.
Yeah, we actually have, it's kind of a cool thing. It always gets some great attention. We have, make sure all the guests have water and are hydrated, especially when we have fellow singers in the studio here. And it's a carton and it says just water and it looks like a... like a milk carton.
Yeah.
Like they're bitching. Isn't that cool?
It's great.
It's great. And so you saw, I immediately turn around. I look at all the certifications. So this is what I do. All of my clients are consumer product goods that are natural, organic, sustainable.
Right.
Reducing greenhouse gases. So anyway, yeah, that's my agency. There's 23 of us up in Portland, and we represent consumer product brands.
So ad agency guy by day and drummer by night, right?
Yeah.
So again, he's a challenge sometimes, but I'll do whatever I can to get these guys on the gig, but I don't turn down gigs either.
Frank, do you handle all of the business within the band, or do you allocate any job duties to anybody else, or is this just all you?
I pretty much do it all myself. I'm kind of a do-it-yourselfer. Probably more than I should, you know, but
it's... You do look just like Tom Petty. I'm like, God dang, man, he looks like Petty.
I always tell people, Frank looks better than Tom. No offense, Tom, but...
Do you get stopped, actually?
All the time. Boy, I got a story. I guess I'm getting off on another tangent.
That's how these things go. We have no script. We're rolling with it. So
we're doing this gig on the Oregon coast Washington coast, Quinault Casino. And it was their kickoff for the big summer concert series, outdoor thing, you know, on the beach in June. Which whoever thought of that is like, Washington coast in June. You got a window from mid-July to the end of August. That's when you book your outdoor gigs on the coast. Anyway, I'm driving along and there's billboards all along the route, and my picture's plastered all over the place, and it just says Petty Fever, Quinault Casino, you know, blah blah blah, and it's like, oh well, that's cool. Well, that's how they were advertising it all over the Northwest. And people came there. They brought vinyl, CDs, shirts. They thought Tom Petty was playing there. So anyway, I'm up there, and people were doing sound check and stuff. They're sticking their head out the window and saying, hey, Tom, can you come up to my room?
And wow.
It's like, hi.
That's great.
He turned around to me during sound check and comes back to the drummer and he goes, Craig, they think I'm Tom Petty. I tell them, no, we're a tribute. My name's Frank. They go, yeah, will you sign this, Tom? I said, I go, Frank.
That's great.
Just sign it, Tom, and make them happy.
That was probably one of the most uncomfortable scenarios of my life.
He was really freaked out about it, but he really made a lot of people happy. I was walking out to my car after the gig, and this woman was walking with her young boy, probably about 8 years old. And she says, your father is going to be so proud that you got Tom Petty's autograph.
I would not want to deceive anybody, you know, but I didn't want to embarrass a lady in front of her kid. You know,
right.
It's like, what do you do?
That's funny. I had one time it's happened to me. Few years back, and the band I was in, you know, another Van Halen tribute, we were doing one of the side stages, and they had all the main action, your Warrants and Great Whites, Rats, bands like that, were staying in the big hotel, and then they had all the side stage bands like in a motel, you know, a couple miles away. And so we finished our gig, went back to the hotel, and they had like a hard rock cafe type bar, and I walked in. I still had like all my stuff and everything, hair still going on, and walked in, and I had my gear bag, and I went to the bartender. I said, hey, can I put my bag back there? You know, I don't want to hold on to it. And then the guy looked at me like, this isn't a bag check. I'm not going to take your bag. And then this dude runs up, you know, also behind the bar and whispers in his ear something. And I'm like, okay, are they going to take my bag or not? I just want a beer, right? Next thing I know, it's like, oh my God, I'm so sorry, Mr. Roth. Yes, yes. Give me your bag. We'll put it back here. What would you like to drink? And before I know, like two girls walked up. I mean, they actually thought, you know, I was David Lee Roth. I'm like, you know, it's kind of similar when you're on stage and, yeah. and playing, you get caught up in it. But, yeah. you know, regular day-to-day stuff like this, I mean, I thought it was amazing. So that was like my one time where someone really thought I was the actual artist. And you get a little flavor of what it must be like for these guys every single day.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, totally.
You must have had those. Have you ever had those shows where, like the one we talk about, Beaver Creek?
Oh.
We just did Beaver Creek Resort, and everyone knew
near
we were
Vail,
a tribute band.
Up in the Rockies.
Right.
They knew we were a tribute band. They did not think we were Tom Petty, but you walked away from that show going, if Tom Petty himself and band were there, they could not have received a better reception from the crowd. The crowd would not have
they
been
were
more
so
into
it.
It.
It was amazing.
And you guys probably have to have that. There's those moments.
There is. There's plenty of moments where it's not like that. Like we were talking about earlier where we played a car dealership.
We don't talk about that.
But there's lots of those gigs. But boy, when you do those gigs like you're talking about, where everybody's into it, and Frank, it doesn't matter what you say in between the songs, they are just all into it, and you're like, cool, I got a new line. Then the next night you do the same line for another group of people, it's like, and it's crickets. Right?
You are correct. That is so correct. Yeah.
It is neat though when you get to do one of those festivals and you know, you have thousands of people and they don't care that you're not the real thing. They just, it's good music. It brings back, you know, lots of memories, and that's what it's about.
I love those moments when, and from the drum riser, if you get a riser, you get to see it because you're up above and you look down and you see this couple and they're like my age and they're looking at each other, singing every word to each other. And you just know that was their high school dance or something. And they're just so into it.
And I'm hoping I'm singing the right
words.
Yeah, right.
I said, Frank, all you got to do is watch their mouths. They're all singing with you. You don't worry about forgetting the words.
Well, and you're looking at the back of Frank with the blonde hair, and it's straight. Okay. And there must be sometimes you're like, wow, this is probably pretty much what it looks like if I was in Tom Petty's band.
Oh, yeah, it is. And he's got the moves down. He's very much into it. Because the music, the way Petty moves on stage is very much the way the music moves you, and Frank does that. So it's a lot of fun. That's why I said last night at the Whisky, and Here Comes My Girl, there was just that moment where he was just in the moment. The band was in the moment. The crowd was in the moment. And you just felt, it's a band. It just doesn't right. get any better.
It's so much fun. So when you're doing this and it's in between songs, are you referring to the crowd and as like I'm Frank, or are you putting on the little, you know, the Tom Petty voice, the way he talks? And
you know, I try not to talk like him. I just, you know, I naturally talk a little slow and slurry. So that's kind of the way Petty talks anyway. So it kind of comes naturally. Yeah. But
right. I mean, because there's plenty of tribute bands where they approach it like this is not only performing the music, but they're acting and they'll portray, you know, the person, you know, to a T and refer to themselves. And it's interesting because I think there's two sides of it, you know, that we don't do that, you know.
Yeah,
no one's coming to my show and are confused that, oh, is this Roth, or, you know, they know it's not. So to me, to do that seems a little odd.
That's my approach. I didn't want to go down that route. You know, I just, again,
maybe I'm not that good. Maybe if I was better, I could be doing that. But, you know, I just, some of the bands do it, and hats off to them.
Yeah. Some guys can do that, but, you know, A, I'm not an actor. And people would pick up on that, if I was trying to do that. You know, I've played in bands over the years where, you know, guys were trying to be somebody they weren't, and you could see the crowd pick up that vibe, and
they
so,
do.
When you're wearing a wig, you just shouldn't be wearing, you know? That's
right.
We did that, actually, the very first show, the one I tell you about where we opened for the Rolling Stones. Great band up Northwest, friends of ours, and we all wore wigs, and I did not want to do it. And a couple of weeks, but we said, all right, we'll do it, because there's one guy in the band.
Really it works for it. Some people, you know, like yeah. if you're doing the David thing.
Yeah.
But
if yeah. it's no question that it's a wig, then you've got the wrong one.
I have to show you a picture. we've got Howard Stern, Mrs. Doubtfire.
Mrs. Doubtfire.
And what was the other one?
we look ridiculous. As you know, you can't spend $5 for a wig, you know.
No.
So the Stevie Nicks was opening for us, Kimberly Hall, great, great singer up in the Northwest, and we were going to play for it. And so she was fixing my wig. I didn't know what the heck to do with a wig, and I can't see the mirror. She fixes it all up. She turns me around, and I go, oh, my God, that's my mother. I just saw my dearly departed mother in the mirror and thought, take this thing off. It freaked yeah. me out.
So they did the wigs for a few gigs, and said, no, they're gone. Just, you know, just look cool.
Yeah. Exactly. Look cool. Own the music. Yeah. Be good at what you do. So I actually had Chris Brightwell from Damage Inc. and a great Metallica tribute. And Chris came in and was demoing some Ultimate Ears in-ear monitors. And so Chris came in, asked for me, and I came to the door, and he didn't know it was me. He had no idea. Wow. He's like, wow. And he didn't. He kind of looked at me and didn't say much, and I helped him out, and we talked and talked and talked. And well, then he came back again, and he had borrowed a couple demos to use for some shows. And he goes, man, I got to tell you, I had no idea you were wearing a wig. And I'm like, there you go.
That's good. That's a good
yeah, that, because that's for the a money, sell right yeah. there.
Because for the money that yeah. I've got to pay for that thing to make yeah. it look legit, you know, when a fellow peer in the industry didn't know, it's like, okay, then it's – it's doing its job.
That's happening. Yeah. yeah.
That is. I remember one of
them. I don't know where you guys got your wigs, yeah. but they weren't.
Oh, no, they weren't. They were not. We, you know, we tried. One of them looked like Captain Beefheart off the rum bottle.
Well, that was either Captain Beefheart or Howard Stern.
Or Howard
that
Stern.
Was, that was Jim.
Yeah. So where are you guys off to tonight? You're down in L.A. for a couple nights. You did the Ultimate Jam last night, yeah. but you're down here for a specific reason.
Yeah, we're playing at the...
Close to that microphone.
Put your mouth on it.
Be a radio guy.
How you doing? Playing at the Hollywood Hard Rock for an event called the Producer's Choice Honors Awards.
Which was previously the L.A. Music
well,
Awards.
Well, it's a spinoff of the L.A. Music Awards. Basically, it's taken the best of 25 years of all the people that have been involved, and they've got a selection committee, a number of industry people, and they selected nominees out of about 12 different categories, I think 10 nominees in each category, you know, to be like the best of the 25-year series. I got nominated for an award. So
nice.
There's also a thing they've been doing for 10-ish years. It's called the Hollywood Fame Awards. And so I'd up for a Career Achievement Award or something like that. So
amazing,
I'll find out tonight.
Very cool. And you guys are going to be playing as well, too.
And we are, there's five or six bands, you know, in between award presentations. And we're doing a 10-minute set.
A 10-minute set. So let's say 10 minutes. So what, three songs?
All right. So, you know.
American Girl?
10 minutes does three Petty songs. You know, I looked at that like that does not do Tom Petty any justice.
It really doesn't.
How so do you, how do I get 12 songs in 10 minutes? We got Craig. The Segway Queen.
Are you doing a
Segway Queen?
Okay, I'll accept that.
A medley?
Yeah, a medley.
Yeah, it's a medley.
Nice.
So, yeah, essentially verse choruses, you know, with the maybe hook riffs.
Right.
And I think we came up with a really good one, and we got, is it 12 or 11 songs?
It's about 11.
Yeah, it was 13. We had the stopwatch out. Got it down like 10 minutes, 10 seconds.
So probably the whole thing with that is you guys probably had to get together and rehearse that.
We actually rehearsed.
You actually rehearsed. I mean, I've been in the Atomic Punks almost 6 years, and I've never done one rehearsal. So that's the beauty of playing with the guys, right?
Yeah. You know, after we've done it for a while, you don't have to rehearse, but, you know, there's stuff we have to rehearse, and this would be one. Yeah, just got to get those transitions and segues down. And Craig's really good about, you know, in terms of the driver, you know, he literally
driver,
is the driver. yeah. Anyway, it should be fun. I'm looking forward to it.
Very cool. Congratulations on that.
Yeah.
So, most memorable experience doing Petty Fever, if you had to pick one thing, besides what we already talked about.
Oh.
Because that's pretty good.
Yeah, well, I was going to say that resort gig this last Labor Day weekend up there in the Rockies, that's one of my more memorable gigs. That was fun. It was just all the planets were in alignment that day.
It's nice when that happens.
Yeah. There's been some really fun ones.
What about the funniest thing that's happened? Anything stand out? Any crazy thing happen with one of the guys in the band? Or
yeah, we were playing a theater, and we're playing along maybe four songs into the set, playing and coming along, and Tim, the other guitar player, supposed to be doing a solo, and it's like, there's no solo. And I look over there, there's no Tim. So he went off to the side of the stage and went to outside, and he had to go to the bathroom.
Oh, no. Every band's got one of those stories, right?
He's not here, so we
can say. Yeah, so, you know, before we...
I'm telling you.
Before you get in the car, make sure you go, you know.
We did a show, and I think I've already brought this up on another podcast, but, man, we did a show in Louisiana, and all of a sudden our drummer just was gone, disappeared. Two songs in, it was like, okay, time for a guitar solo. Even it is a little bit early. Well, as we wind down the show, there's a couple questions I always ask every artist. So let's talk about your three favorite albums, three albums that you would only have for the rest of time, like a desert island thing. Like you've got an actual power on a desert island and you've got a turntable and you can have three records. What would they be?
The first Jimi Hendrix album.
Okay.
Our Experience. Jeff Beck, Blow by Blow. And
got a lot of guitar flavor going on here today.
And the Beatles' Abbey Road.
Got it. Three good choices.
Yeah, and that's a hard call, because if you ask me tomorrow, I may give you.
It does change, you know. It could change week to week, well, depending on
mood
on the mood.
Yeah, you know, that's the cool thing about music. You know, that's makes the world go around. Yeah.
There you go. You don't have to have a favorite. It's all, you can have a favorite, but you know, it's, you can have lots of different flavors.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Speaking of flavors, favorite food. Food you can't live without. You
gotta have cheeseburger.
Cheeseburgers. Not good for lead singers, though.
No.
But you got everything in moderation.
Well, okay. So it's not like I eat cheeseburgers every day. That's what makes it even better, you know, when I do get to eat my cheeseburger. Yeah.
So if you're in Southern California, are you having some In-N-Out while you're here?
Yeah, that's on our list today.
Got to. I made him go to Pink's last night. They hadn't been to Pink's hot dogs up in Hollywood. Chili cheese dog, man. Oh, gotta have them.
What was your take?
I had the chili cheese dog without the chili.
Frank backed out of the
chili. I always thought Pink's is overrated. I don't get it. I've had, yeah, every like 5, 6, 7 years or whatever, I'm like, I'm in the area. Okay, let's go and get in line. And I don't know. I'd rather go have Wiener Schnitzel if I'm going to have something like that. I don't know.
So you get it all the time. Up in Portland, we didn't have a Pink's to go to. We didn't have any Wiener Schnitzel. Their Wiener Schnitzel.
God, that place. I don't know if I could do that again. Yeah. That place as well, too. It's tough getting old and trying to eat. Yeah. Right?
Right.
Yeah, it's not like 20, 30, 40. Well, you know, back in the old days.
How about favorite TV show growing up?
Ooh, Star Trek.
Star Trek. Boy, he's showing his age. He's got Star Trek.
I heard about Beck, that show.
Hendrix, the Beatles. You look great, though, man. I mean, again, it's funny. I get a lot of people in here. Yeah, you know,
turning 35 this spring.
35.
I'll never tell.
There you go. All right. Where can everybody find Petty Fever? Give us all that social media stuff here. Time to plug the band.
Okay. So website, pettyfever.com, facebook.com/pettyfever, twitter.com/pettyfever.
Lots of creative stuff going on here, right?
Instagram.com/pettyfever. So we got a trend going here.
And you're running all of that, right?
Unfortunately. Yeah, I hear that. It gets overwhelming. I am not a tech guy. Well, I'm a hack, so I know how to get around, but I can sit to a guy that really knows how to get around and just go, why am I doing this? You know. So,
Frank, thanks for coming in. Craig, appreciate you coming in. Don't forget about In-N-Out today. Petty Fever, you guys rock, man.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks for listening to this week's Cover Your Ears podcast. I hope you enjoyed the show. Most likely, you will go on a little Tom Petty binge of music. That's what I did. So happy New Year to you, and thank you for helping make Cover Your Ears so successful. In the coming weeks, look for some exciting news on the podcast that I plan to unveil in January. This week's artist spotlight is TeamMate. Now, this is an interesting one. TeamMate is comprised of Scott Simons and Danny Buchner. Scott and Danny were once a couple. When Danny came out to Scott, the two broke up. But instead of them both going their own ways, the two instead stuck it out and formed the synth pop duo TeamMate. Now, I usually don't like this type of music. You know, I'm a little bit more hardcore guy. But this is really catchy stuff. I think you're going to like it. The song called Nothing's Ever Over. And again, the band is called TeamMate. Enjoy.
Complicated. Said we want it all or nothing.
Cover Yours is brought to you by Heil Sound. Heil is all about that perfect sounding microphone. And it just so happens they've been doing it for quite some time. 50 years of rock. So be a part of it. Anybody that's been around that long is definitely for real. Check out their website at www.heilsound.com. Check for brand new episodes of Cover Your Ears each and every Tuesday. I'd love to hear your feedback too. You can contact me with any comments, suggestions, or questions at briangellervo@gmail.com. And if you like the podcast, please make sure and leave a review wherever you may have found Cover Your Ears. And do a guy a favor, tell a friend. Oh, and if you have something interesting to say and you're in the business, let me know. It could make for a fun show. See you next week.